softball, then you are going to love the Fast Pitch TV show. We're bringing you more interviews, more videos, and more product reviews than anyone else on the planet. Sit back and get ready. Here's the Fast Pitch TV show.
Hello, I'm Gary Leland, and I'm the host of the Fast Pitch TV show. Now, if you've never been to my website, please take a look at fastpitch.tv. Now, that's the home of the Fast Pitch TV network and the place you'll find all my softball videos and blogs. It's the largest network for free softball videos, blog posts, and softball tools on the internet, okay? So it's got a lot of information. It has a great forum for talking about fast pitch softball too. Now I upload this show on the 1st and the 15th of every month, but there's something's happening there all the time. So please take a look, but wait till after you finish watching this episode, of course. Now I also want to take this opportunity to tell you about the magazine I'm producing for the Apple iPad. New issues come out the first week of every month. And we have a great, great group of writers. Our lineup of writers are great, like Olympians Kat Osterman, Natasha Wally, and so many more. Now, if you have an iPad, you really need to visit fastpitchmagazine.com today and check it out. Now, this is not a fun little magazine for kids. This is a serious coaching tool for coaches, players, and parents. You're gonna love it, okay? Now, this week I'm bringing you another session from Softball Con. If you're not familiar with Softball Con, you really, really should check out their website, and it's located at softballcon.net. It's a great softball clinic that's held in Louisville, Kentucky every January. I've been to every one. Now this week we have part one of a clinic by Shonda Stanton, head coach at Marshall University. And now she's being helped in this clinic by Amanda Williams, who is a 7-year veteran with the NPF, okay? Today's clinic is It may be small ball, but it can lead to big results. Let's watch it now.
All right, let's get started. We're going to talk about small ball. You know, we're going to include bunting in that. We're going to include base running in that. She may demo a couple things. You know, we talk all the time about the little things. And if you're too big to do the little things, you're too little to do big things. And for me, my philosophy is very aggressive. 2 years ago, we led the nation in stolen bases. Last year, we were second in the nation in stolen bases. We are not as fast this year, and I've got to adjust my style. We're still going to be aggressive, but you've got to go with your personnel. And so you're talking about a team that likes to run. I mean, we're stealing 130 bases a year. If you look at the D1 stats, that's a lot of stolen bases. She, I think, maybe had like one sacrifice bunt in like 4 years. And that's a kid that came in to me as a slapper and that we turned into a hitter, and we just didn't have, you know, the personnel that we needed. We needed her to just hit. So you got to go with whatever your personnel is. So my philosophy is very aggressive. We're going to get after it. We like to hit and run. We like to squeeze. We like to attack the defense. We just spent all week working on bunting because now I'm going to have to adjust based on our personnel because we got a little bit more bigger girls, you know. Big booty, big power, okay? So we're not as quick as we used to be, and so I will adjust and we'll run. We have two kids that will probably steal, they could steal 110 bases between the two kids, but that's gonna require them to hit 400 and get on base more. They're that fast, but we don't have the six kids that we've had in the past. So let's talk speed. If you're gonna have somebody that turns into a slapper, our speed, what we use at our level is 2.7, 2.8, all right? Now, mind you, we've led the nation in stolen bases. We've had one kid that's a 2.71. So I get phone calls all the time that tell me, hey, this kid's a 2.6. We time on contact and then first step at first base, all right? And again, our small ball is very good. I mean, that's something that has been our strength. We'll have kids that have come to us that are a 2.9, and those kids need to power slap at our level. They've got to drive the ball through. But there's plenty of kids that, you know, I've seen in our area and all over, like when we're recruiting, that are running a 2.9, 3.0 that are very successful at the travel ball level. But when they get to us, we've got to go ahead and make them power slap. All right, so we're looking for kids that are about a 2.7, 2.8, that are going to be able to just put the ball in play and run it out. All right, so speed. I would rather steal than sacrifice bunt. But again, we don't have the personnel this year, so I told our kids if they want to be in the lineup, they have to be able to bunt. All right, you have got to be a proficient bunter if you want to be in our lineup this year. So I'm going to go through bunts real quick, just our technique and what we teach. I'll try not to go through it too long because I want to get through some things. Actually, I want to do this because I always have too much information. I'm going to give you a couple drills because I like drills, and then we'll work backwards. A good base running drill. go ahead and, if this is first base, get some girls in a circle, all right? And they're gonna go ahead and they're gonna just start jogging, all right, in a circle. And they're gonna always hit first base. So you've got a group at first base, you've got a group at second, and a group at third. And all they're doing is running in a circle. And what happens if a kid stutter steps when she goes to hit first base? What's gonna happen to your circle? Yeah, it's gonna jam up, right? And so it's just teaching those kids, because how many times do you see girls when you're base running, you know, they slow down, you know, they're taking a stutter step, and so it's just keeping that rhythm and making sure when they're hitting that base that they're being nice and fluid and they're not breaking things down there, okay? So you can put your girls, just divide them up, put them at each of the bases, and get them going in a circle. You can speed your circle up, you can slow your circle down, okay? A second base running drill. Put a whistle at a coach or a player standing behind the base, all right? Put a whistle in your pitcher's mouth, all right? Now, this is a drill my assistant heard at the convention. We haven't done it yet. I can't wait to do it. I keep saying that, but we may run out of time. We play in 2 weeks. I'll probably have to wait for fall ball. When the pitcher releases, she does exhale, so she will blow the whistle, all right? The coach is going to blow the whistle when the kid gets off the base. What should happen to the whistles? They should be in sync. Okay? And so that's great feedback. Great feedback. So again, not a drill I've done. If it doesn't work, don't use it. You know, we make up stuff all the time, and you know what works, we use. We adapt drills all the time, so that's a drill. Other base running drills that we use all the time, and again, you've got to focus on base running. It's what we like to do. We like to run, and so it's natural to us. And I know you have so much to get through in a day, but you've got, you know, you got to get your hitting in, you got to get your defense in, but you have to get base running in. Right after you get your warm-up in, go ahead and just give 10 minutes and get some base running in. Partner up, me and Amanda are partners, and we'll do stagger. So she'll go first, she'll run a single, right? I'll go second, and I'll run a double. All right, so we're still partners, but now she's at first, I'm at second. She's gonna go, so now we're off of pitcher, she's gonna go first to third, she's sliding in at third, I'm gonna go second to home, and she's tagging at third. When we get back to home, we're gonna switch, and I'm gonna run the single now, and she's gonna run the double. So it's just getting your, you know, different base running drills in. The other one is you divide evenly at the bases. From first to second, you're gonna straight steal. From second to third, you're gonna score. Where the drill gets screwed up is the person who scored needs to go to third. Because now you're gonna work on tagging. All right, now I'm gonna jump all over the place. I had an outline, and again, I don't follow outlines. And those of you that are just coming in, any information that you want, I will get you that information. Email me, and I gave my contact information earlier. If you didn't get it, come up and I'll give it to you after. At third base.
There's some seats up here.
You guys want to squeeze in and let them have a seat? Anybody, if we can just kind of move on down a little bit. You guys can come on and have a seat. All right, let's talk about the lead at third, okay? We teach left foot on the base. And this is a situation where we're not forced. Or we're not having to attack home. We're letting the ball get through the infield, right? Now, if we're doing angle down or we're going on the hit or contact, I tell them get comfortable, do whatever foot you want. All right, but this is, we're hoping to get a sack fly here, and we want to make sure we don't get cheated. So left foot on the bag, all right? She'll take her lead off. So it's one step, crossover back, one step on. And now she sees it caught, and she takes off. All right, some people teach, you know, on my command, you know, if you have kids, you know, start at a line, you have two kids on a line, and you raise your hand, and you yell go and drop your hand, the kid that has their eyes closed and is listening to you is going to be off later than the kid who's watching your hand go down. All right, so I never tell my kids to go. All I do is as soon as the ball's up in the air, I yell tag, tag, tag. I get my butt down the line. She's scoring. I just hold her up. That's my only job. My only job out there is to hold a kid up. Now, I say hold a kid up, if you come watch us play, you'll have a kid running first, she'll be the hitter, and she just scored a runner, and she's that backside runner, and I'll be like this. So my lead arm is for the front runner, and this arm is for the backside runner. So you'll see me hold this kid up at second, and all of a sudden she's sliding in at third, and you'll think, gosh, she just ran through a stop sign. She did not. My job was to stop her at second, because the play has not developed enough. The outfielder fielded it. We don't know yet at where she's throwing, so I'm saying hold up, it's your read now. All right, so then our kid reads it. Your kids cannot rely on you. All right, they have got to react and read the game. So I hold that kid up, this kid scored, and now she's rounded big and she sees the throw went through, I can advance if she's off, right? If I hold her up and she's standing at second base on the hold, just cruising in, when that ball gets away, that backup's going to throw her out at third. So you've got to teach your kids to be aggressive. I know I said I was going to talk about bunts, but I got a lot of bunts. Let me go to commands, and then we'll go back to bunts. All right, we have absolutes in our program, and we talk about this all the time. I'm okay with an aggressive mistake. If we're going to make a mistake, commit to it and be aggressive. I don't want them to be stupid, but I do want them to be aggressive. If you hesitate, you stay put. Any hesitation. So you get out there, you're in your lead, the ball's in the dirt, and you're doing a dance out there, stay put. You'll go the next time. All right, but don't be fooled twice. All right, any hesitation, we stay put. Ball in the dirt, you'll hear our whole dugout yelling, get there, get there, get there. Your team should have a verbiage, a language, where everybody, it's not about, you know, if you come watch our team play, we're very loud, we're very enthusiastic, we're so much into the game, but you should be hearing a lot of the same things come out of the dugout. A kid doesn't dive for a ball and it drops, you should hear 18 kids yelling, lay down! Alright, so whatever it is, I just don't want our kids to be noisy in the dugout, I want them to have intent. Alright, so that's why we have some of these, some of this language that we talk about all the time. Big rounds. Constantly telling our kids, you know, they hit a single, she's saying round it, round it, round it, she wants them out there. You know, that way when the throw gets away, we can advance. So we're always getting as far away from, the further the ball is away from you, the further you can be away from what? The base. Okay, sounds simple, but watch your kids. It drives me nuts. We were working on base running last week, and you know, the ball's hit up in the air. They took their lead at second, the ball's hit up in the air. What's their first step? Back. Like, is it gonna be caught? No, get out there. If it's going to be caught, you know, the only time you're going to go back is if you're tagging. Okay? Or freeze on a line. We say that all the time. Line drive, freeze. If you're at third, you may need to be diving back in immediately. But freeze on a line. Never retreat. I'll constantly say that to our kids because it drives me nuts when we're working on the base running drills like I just talked about. Want that next 60 feet? Preach that constantly to them. It's all about that next 60 feet. It's all about getting in scoring position. Want it, want it, want it. Turn your back, get down. So the play's happening. The minute you turn your back on the ball, you need to be down at the next base. I don't want any what ifs, ands about it. You just get down because you're obviously not paying attention to what's going on. So get down. Out quick, back quick. You know, a lot of times people will take their leads and they're dancing around out there, baiting the throw. We don't need to get picked anywhere. There's no reason. We don't need to play around. Get out. The ball will be caught at that point in time. If it's behind, you're advancing. You didn't hesitate. You're going. And you're out quick, you're back quick. Two outs, two bases. You'll see me anytime runners at second. I'll just be standing like this. So they know two outs and we're going two bases. So again, I'm not stopping them. They're coming second to home all the way because there's two outs. Now when they bobble it, the kid's safe up first. There's no go, go, go. She's already gone. And then those are some absolutes. I know I'm jumping all over the place. Leads. Let's talk about leads. And then we'll go to bunts. We teach track start. There's track start and there's rocker start. Show them rocker start. Rocker start, you're kind of behind the bag, you get in motion and you go. 2005. So Amanda was a
junior.
And we changed our philosophy. We timed our kids, we filmed our kids. Every kid but one was quicker and on time when they did a track start. I allowed one kid, and now since 2000, what year was it? 2005, we've allowed two kids to use a rocker start. Time your kids, film them, do what works for you. But I tell you what, the kids are doing the rocker start, and I do believe, yeah, hurt something in motion, it's easier to get in motion, just like hitting. We have rhythm, and then we go. But your kids, they're getting in that rocker step, and they're doing all kinds of crazy stuff with their hands, and their foot's coming up, and they're not getting off on time. All right, if they are, let them do it. But I guarantee they're not getting off on time. So we do track start. We're in front of the bag. I don't care, right foot, left foot on the bag. Toes, knees, hips, shoulders facing the direction that you're running. This is so important. Just even in their warm-ups, preach to them. Every kid of ours, they'll start and they'll have that right foot or left foot and it's turned. And what's the first thing they do? They pick that foot up, right? And they get it going in the direction they're running. And how many times are you out at second base by what? A step. And so that step, it's the little things that are gonna really make a difference. And so watch them, you know, just, they're doing their stretching drills, their running drills. I tell them, hey, get your toes, knees, hips pointing in the direction you're going. So that's what we want. Opposite arm, opposite knee. All right, we swipe the ground all the time. So if you come watch our game, you know, you'll see our kids swipe the ground, and that's just reminding them to get low. All right, we want them coming out, exploding out, and they'll, you know, they'll get full steam as they're coming out of their, into their stride. All right, so those are our lead offs, what we teach with that. And so, as far as the lead out itself, every single time they're coming off the base, we want the other team to think that we're stealing. So what we do when we're coming off the base is we give a little head dip, and that's because that's typically what girls are going to be doing when they're actually stealing that base. So every time we take a lead up, our objective is to make the other team think that we are stealing. That way when we are stealing, it's not obvious. Alright, we'll go back and talk bunny now. Don't you love that I jump all over the place? Alright, and again, if you want something very neat and concise on an outline, I do have it, and I can email that to you. Alright? And if you don't hear from me right away, you know, give me a couple days and email me again. Things get crazy, and we leave in 2 weeks for Tampa, so I know our focus will, you know, when you email me, I'll say what's important now, and then maybe the email back may not be the most important thing that moment, but I promise I will get to you at some point in time, on my time. All right, Bunny, again, our style has to change this year. We have two really fast kids, and then we're not fast, and so we're going to have to bunt. And it's going to drive me nuts, but we will get that next 60 feet. We'll give up an out, and we'll get there. Sacrifice bunts. You can either go ahead and pivot, or you can go ahead and just quarter turn and get comfortable. All right, whatever is comfortable for your kids. I want the bat in your eyes. I want your nose between your hands. I like a pincher grip, all right? And, you know, all our kids want to do this when they come to me. They're down here, okay? You just don't have the back control. So I want them here. Right. I want this hand comfortable where you're going to slap from. So if you're a right-hander, and again, you're selling sacrifice bunt, those corners are charging hard, and we're just going to get a nice, sharp, hard ground ball past those corners charging. I want to be in a position where all you got to do is slide this hand down and drive. Okay, so that'll be our slap. But we'll talk about that in a second. So that's where the bottom hand should be, wherever you're comfortable to slap from. All right, sacrifice bunt. Hand in your eyes. We're only bunting strikes. All right. One thing that some of our kids do is they get too far out here with their hands, and they get their weight too far out. What do you think when the ball comes? Have you ever seen it stop in midair? No, it doesn't happen, right? Anybody ever see that? I've seen some crazy things, but I've never seen that ball stop, right? And they're going after that ball. That ball will come to them, promise it, okay? So I don't want them lunging out on that. I want their weight centered, and I want them comfortable and balanced, all right? I want nose between, elbows relaxed. We'll see a lot of elbows up too. The minute you have an elbow up, you're not giving with both hands. And you know, we'll have kids, I tell you what, we have Division I athletes that I think are pretty good. And I'll, you know, just the other day, hey, where do you want the bunt? And they're wanting to bunt down the lines. Bunt for a base hit, we'll bunt down the lines. But yeah, in baseball, yeah, they want to bunt down the lines, not in softball. We want to bunt where the pitcher and the corners converge. And I tell you what, any kid that runs a 2-7-2-8 from the left side, we had a kid that, her name was Melissa Losini, and our doctor called her Melissa No Swing because she was only allowed to bunt because she was fast. And every team in our conference knew she was only bunting, and she, at one point in time in the season last year, was leading our team, and we called it bunting average because she wasn't even hitting. All right, so those guys almost set them all over the place. All right, as far as bunting, again, don't lunge after it. You want to go ahead and catch the ball in the back. You'll see people stab at it. You're going to get a rocket bunt there. We're not push bunting right now. We're go ahead and we're catching on it. We want to over-exaggerate and bring the bat into our chest, because if we do that, we're not going to be able to run yet. And how many times do you see kids, you're sacrificing yourself, you're giving yourself out, and they're exploding through the box, and you're wondering why the ball's popped up. Okay, do your job. Stay put, over-exaggerate it, bring the bat in, drop the bat, and then take off. Okay, if you're out, you're out.
Right. Another thing is you want to make sure that we're starting at the top of that strike zone. If we are having to go lower, that we're moving with our legs and not our bat head. And we want to hit the outside part of the ball, because that's going to put it into a fair territory. A lot of times you'll see kids and they don't ever even get that bat angle. They're starting off in foul territory. So we want to make sure you're getting that outside part of the ball.
Okay, when she's, we want to kind of that nose over the knee. You know, we don't want you, again, out too far. Bumper base hit. Right-handed. We're talking a right-hander. And, you know, again, I know this sounds very trivial and very easy, but I tell you what, I know our kids aren't doing the job before they get to me, because we had to spend, we have 11 newcomers this year, and we taught them all everything in fall ball, what we teach. And this week in bunting, we did a bunting circuit, and we were atrocious, absolutely atrocious with our technique. And our kids know it, and they're going to work on it, and they're going to get refocused. But for a bumper base hit, this is what we teach. Let's just talk lower half. All right, I want them to get in a good running position from this position. All right, so all they're going to do, whatever it takes to get there, a little hop up, there they are. Okay, I don't want to take a step away from first base. I just want to be nice and athletic, somehow get this right leg in a position where I'm almost in my track start now. Now let's talk hands. Okay, I'm here, and again, it's a sneaky bunt, right? So it's delayed, the corners are a little bit back. All right, now we've down the line is fine, all right? So we're here, all I'm doing is bringing in this bottom hand, kind of like to a holster here, right? What we'll see here, I mean, how many kids the other day just on our team? They're coming here, they're creating that space. We don't want that space. What happens as soon as you turn and create that space? What are you doing? You're tipping off the corners now. All right, so again, we want our shoulders staying square to the plate. I'm here, I'm bringing that down to the holster here, so I'm just sliding my hand up, cupping it, bam, and I go. So easy, but it's not. I tell you, you gotta focus on with your kids. If your kids can master this, and they're a kid that's got decent speed, they're gonna be on. From the left-hand side, you know, as far as Bob Furbay said, I'm a real big fan of a two-handed drag, and why I like the two-handed drag is we had a kid one year, she had one double in two seasons, and she was 2004 MAC Player of the Year. She bunted and slapped, that's all she did. She never hit the ball in the infield, never, ever, ever. And she was probably one of our slower, she was probably on the higher, closer to the 2.8, you know, one range. But she would do the two-handed drag, so when she'd come up, she slapped and bunted from the same hand position. Now it's tougher, because I did talk earlier, remember, I think you have more back control if you're here, you do. Okay, and so it's so much easier. You know, a lot of our kids will just do the split bunt. So a lot of our lefties will just come up and split bunt. So that's what your split bunt looks in. You know, go ahead and cup it. So a lot of kids will do that for us, our lefty slappers. But if I want our kids to be proficient bunters, I want them to keep their hands here and be able to bunt and slap from the same position. Because then the corners are like, gosh, what do I do? Do I bite? Do I need to stay tighter, or is she gonna slap it by me? So if you can get your kids to do a two-handed drag, work on it.
So the main thing with the two-handed drag is just making sure that they're getting it on the last like 3 inches part of the back, because that's what's going to deaden the ball. Because a lot of times you'll see these kids come in to two-handed bunt and they're having these like rocket bunts. So you just want to make sure that they're having that good touch, that good back control, and then putting that ball right in this area. So what we'll do is we'll tape the bats just to give them a visual, and then they're just trying to bunt it within that area there.
All right, let's talk about a lefty slapper. You know, who should lefty slap? And again, it depends on your level, your area. You got to know the times. And for us, you know, I said we've got to have somebody that's at 2.7 something to 2.8 something. And we have a kid right now is the fastest kid ever in our program. And we just were talking that do we take a kid who is a great righty? Well, we don't. We think she will be a great righty double hitter. And now I'll turn her into a single hitter. Probably no need to. And we're struggling with that because she, by far, she's the best kid in our program. She was recruited to run Pac-12 track. And so we're probably gonna keep her on the right side right now. And this is a kid that's gonna be the fastest in our program. And hopefully will break a lot of records for us. And this is, you know, a program that runs. You know, we lead the nation in stolen bases a lot of times. So don't just turn kids around to turn them around. And if it is a kid that aspires to play at the next level, and she is a 2.9/3.0, if you are turning around, you got to make sure that she can power slap, because she's not going to be able to regular slap at the next level. All right, slapping. Let's talk about the different types of slappers. We have a soft touch where we're just going to go ahead and maybe get it to the 5-6 hole or the shortstop, maybe get a 2-bouncer. We've got a slapper that's just going to go ahead and put bat on ball. We don't care what her technique looks like, and she's just beating it out. And then we've got the power slapper, who is more just a hitter in motion. All right. Now, the hitter in motion, the power slapper, has to make sure when she comes through that her hands stay back. Okay. So that her hands are back and she has that separation, because that's what we teach when we hit. If we're going to have power, we want to have separation. This is the only kid that does not bring her hands with her when she starts to slap. If your kids are slapping, when that back foot moves, your hands better move, okay? You never wanna outrun your hands, all right? So we teach our kids, as this moves, your hands need to move, all right? But now if you're a 2.9/3.0 at our level and you need to drive the ball through, we don't want your hands moving. Okay, so we understand the difference between power slap and regular slap. All right, as far as some drill, you know, let's talk lower half. If you are teaching it to somebody new, please don't teach the back step, okay? Now, everybody, only if they're gonna come to lunch, because I take that out, and that's the hardest thing for our kids to take out, because we're creatures of habit, and we've been so successful, so don't change it, I don't wanna do it differently. But our goal with a slapper, especially our fast kids, when this crossover foot comes forward, we want it at the top of the box. Because we want you closer to what? First, okay? So if we, and so positioning in the box. Stand wherever, when you cross over, that front foot's gonna be on the top of the box. You know, all your kids can stand somewhere different because you have all kinds of kids that have different strides, all right? So we don't teach, you know, come back, because the minute they come back, they're not covering the ground they should have covered. You just defeated the purpose of getting them where we want them, all right? So all we teach is to go ahead, be comfortable in the box, however you want to get open to be able to run, whatever that takes. Now, I do have some kids that bring their foot up and down. I do have some kids that slightly bring it back, okay? But they're not taking away the ground. All right, so we just teach you comfortable, and we're just gonna run through the box. Don't run it, outrun your hands. And you know what? It's all about contact for those fast kids. So slow it down if you have to. Just like a hitter, your preparation phase. You know, if you gotta get ready to swing, if you need to slow it down and get it going a little bit sooner, slow it down, get it done sooner, and be ready to hit. Same thing, be ready to make contact, whatever that means. All right, let's talk about some drills. You can go ahead and just have a tee. How are we on time? 1:25, what time are we done? 1:50? We getting anything out of it, or am I going too fast and talking at you too crazy? Are we all right? We good? All right, if you get one thing, it's hopefully effective. This drill will be, you know, the biggest thing with slappers, they always want to peel out, right? And actually, if you do studies, because I've read an article on it, I've never thought about it this way, but I used to have a kid that ran at the pitcher, and I thought too much. And I was like, she's taking one too many steps to the pitcher. Now, I don't want her peeling out immediately, but honestly, it's a shorter distance. And so she was okay to be running at the pitcher as far as she was. So we want our kids going in that direction. When they cross over and that foot comes down, we want it pointing anywhere from the shortstop to the third base line. Okay, so when that foot comes down, we want it anywhere from the shortstop to the third base line. All right, so the first drill is a grab drill. She's gonna go through and she's just gonna pick the ball up.
Can I do it faster?
Not yet, you can just, yeah. So when she picks the ball up, this is gonna prevent her from peeling out, right? Because if you peel out, you're not gonna be able to pick the ball up off the tee. So it's just grab drill.
So you do want to make sure after we get this crossover step and we're here, that the very next step is to the pitcher and not down the first baseline, because that's where you'll get to see people. If after they take this initial step here, that next step is here, now it's tough for us to reach that outside pitch. So that's the next important step. After we get that first step to the front of that box, is that next step needs to be towards the pitcher.
All right, next drill, and you can put a glove on. I'm going to have a glove here, but same thing. She's just going to hit the ball off of the tee. So she's going to do the same thing. So the first one, she's grabbing it. The second one, she's just going to hit the ball off the tee. Okay, so just put the glove on it and make sure. And obviously, you can put cones out. You know, you can give them targets. You can do whatever you want as far as, you know, how you want them to hit it off. But another one that you can just add, a conditioner. You can have a pitcher just kind of going through a motion and pitching to them. And you know, I'll go ahead and she'll catch it and run through. As conditioner, she's got to run the ball to me. And she can backpedal and get ready. And we'll just go again. And she's got to run it to me. So it is teaching her to stay at the pitcher. But then we're just adding a few more steps. And you can, you know, go further. It depends how much conditioning you want to get in. And you can have them shuffle back. You can have them backpedal back. You can have them sprint back. So just, you know, something to get those slappers in. You know, we will do a lot of breakdown stuff with our slappers where they just start in their crossover position. They do whatever, it doesn't matter. So it depends, remember, again, keep in mind, is she a power slapper? You know, right now she's just gonna be slapping because her elbow's down, her hands have come forward. All right, if she's power slapping, she would go up like that. All right, so we'll just do some breakdown stuff where we start in the crossover position and we'll just stay there. We'll do it where we go ahead and continue with the step, right? And then we'll go back and just add the crossover. So just, it's important for them to break down their technique, to understand what they're doing. But the biggest thing is make contact. We'll do a drill where we'll put the screen on the field and tell your kids, you know what? I want the ball to bounce over the net. Let them figure it out. Don't give them any, you know, I think sometimes we over coach and over technique things and say, your bat's gotta be here, you gotta have this angle, you gotta do this. If your kids can hit that ball over the net, they have good bat control, right? And then they're getting some bounce. And I'll tell our kids, if our kids give me two bounces, they're safe. I don't care who we're playing, if they give me two bounces, they are safe. And so put them out there, get that screen out there, and tell them, give me some bounce, hop that net. You want to talk about the drill as far as where they want, where you put your target, where you want them slapping in?
Just for the bounce, or what?
Yeah.
The first bounce.
Yeah, like you were saying, we want to get them those two bounces, but you want to get that ball within, 5 feet or so of home plate. So you can put down like bucket lids or whatever you have, bases, anything, and you just want them concentrating on getting that first bounce, hitting whatever that target is to get them that high bounce. Another thing is with slappers, a lot of times what you'll see is they don't utilize the outside pitch. They're so worried about getting to first base, they're not hitting that outside pitch, but really that low and outside pitch is the best pitch for a slapper to hit. It's gonna give you that low and outside one, it's gonna automatically give you that nice angle to get that good bounce. So even if it's a ball or two or three even outside, they need to utilize and even hit balls because it's gonna be able to get them into a position to get us that good bounce. So make sure that you are having your girls not just swing at strikes, that they're widening that zone. You can set tees up, a foot or two outside and just have them realize, if I'm getting to the front of that box where I need to be, I can reach that outside pitch. Because they're like, oh, I can't reach it. It's because they're so worried about getting to first base. So make sure that they're getting to the front of that box and that we're just working on getting balls outside of the strike zone to let them realize that they can use that pitch.
Then with their slappers, when they're taking, if they're not power slapping, I don't care what they do with their swing after contact. All right, and so many times, and that was a struggle with some of our kids when they first come into our program, is they're taking these big old cuts and they're just trying to slap and beat it out. So go ahead and put the plate down. And like she was talking about zone, put the balls on the plate and then put a couple balls off the plate where you just have them lined up here. So if I had, if I had the plate, you're just putting the balls down on the ground. And just so they can visually see balls and then put a couple off the plate and ask the kid, which ones are you comfortable hitting? All right, and because they've got to know what they're comfortable doing, but they've got to be able to hit balls that are off the plate, because it is about getting on. And those are the kids that we want the ball put in play. We've faced teams before where they've pitched a different pitcher besides their starter because of our small ball, because they wanted somebody more athletic on the mound that could field it. And so you cannot underestimate the ability to put the ball in play. And then check your small ball kids. Their walks should outweigh their strikeouts. And we just were looking at stats the other day. We just did the 20th year of Marshall softball, and we just did an all anniversary team. And so we went through some of the career kids that had great numbers, and those great hitters had more walks than strikeouts. And it's a problem if your slappers have more strikeouts than walks. So if we're gonna focus on any stat with our slappers, we're going to focus on their walk to strikeout ratio. And our kids know it. And sure, on base is important, but I want to focus on that number, because then your on base percentage is going to go up. Your on base percentage goes up, you're going to have more stolen bases. So that kid that is only stealing, once a game, she's getting on two or three times. Now she's stealing twice a game, and now she's going to get 50, 60 stolen bases for us as opposed to 30. And since we only have two this year, they're going to need to get 50 or 60.
Something with the hands that she was talking about, as far as why we bring our hands with us when we're just doing like soft slaps and regular slaps, is because we want to get on the plane of that ball. And all it is now is just a flick of my bat head, as opposed to getting here and now I'm trying to take this big swing and do all this stuff. I'm just trying to get on the plane of that ball, have that bat control, boom, it's just a flick of that bat head.
And so with two strikes, put the ball in play. You'll see kids all the time, how many times people were yelling, she was bunny. No, she got there on the path of the ball and realized it was because she couldn't handle, and so she just kind of flicks at it, and now she's got life. Because it's all you want. You want to live for another pitch. You want to live for another pitch, you always have a chance.
Do you need a softball bat? Do you want to save $30? Softballjunk.com is offering an additional $30 discount off the price of all non-sale softball bats on their website. That's right, $30. So the next time you buy a bat, go to softballjunk.com and enter the code FPTV30 during checkout, and wham! You just put a cool $30 in your pocket.
Welcome back. Now that last short clip, that was my daughter Amanda, and she was telling you about my website, softballjunk.com. Make sure and write down the code number she gave you, FPTV30, because anytime you buy a baseball or softball bat on my website, you can enter that code at checkout and save yourself $30 right off the price. And you can use the code over and over and over. It's a great deal. You just need to remember the code, and that's FPTV30. Share it with your friends. Help them out. Now, this show was originally started to promote softballjunk.com. So if you enjoy the show at all, I ask you at least check out my website, softballjunk.com, the next time you're looking for softball equipment, bats, balls, whatever. If I offer a competitive price, please buy from me and show some support for the show. It's a great way to support what I'm doing here. Now, I hope you've enjoyed part one of Shonda's clinic. Please check back for part two on the next episode. Please tell your friends about Fastpitch TV, and don't forget to check out the Fastpitch TV app for the iPhone and iPad at fastpitch.tv. Until next time, this is Gary Leland saying goodbye, and thanks for watching.
This show is a member of the Fastpitch TV network. See all our shows and blogs at www.fastpitch.tv.